repeat there. I think it's really complementary to what I'm going to talk about here, whereas we're looking at the drone platform as a platform that can carry different sensors for helping with not only wildlife, but native wildlife, but invasive animal management as well. So it's not moving. Oh, there we go. Oh, now I've gone too far. Previous. There we go. Sorry, get the hang of it. All right. So, just a bit of an intro. There's a couple of different technologies I'll be talking about. One is radio tracking technology from the drone. So with this technology, we can actually track multiple tagged animals simultaneously. So they can be of the same species or they could be multiple species. And the locations of those are all mapped in real time. While the drone is still in the air, you can actually see the signals from all of the tags at the same time. We find that people are really looking for this kind of a solution where they work in really rugged and remote landscapes. But equally for people who are working in really flat landscapes where they aren't able to actually find a high point to maximise their signal. So in order to get that maximum range of picking up that tag signal, you can launch the drone and create that high point wherever needed. We can also minimise the disturbance if you're trying to observe natural behaviour of the animals. So if you're in doing control measures, for example, you might want to identify where the animals are before you send in a crew on the ground for really targeted action on the ground. And so you can do that because we're using triangulation as one of the methods that are being used to find animals across the landscape. And so you can do it from a distance. In fact, if you're away from the animal, it's better because you can get a nice clean direction in the way it's going, and then you can move around and get intersecting lines. We can also not only detect and map those signals, but we can also read them. So if you have animals that have a mortality signal tag, we can actually see what the pulse rates are of those tags in real time. So that can alert you immediately whether or not that animal has stopped moving. So that's one extra capability that has become available just this year. And we can also attach third-party GPS download systems whereby we can download onboard log data remotely as well. So there's a sort of a wide range of the radio tracking and just locating a thing is one aspect of it. There's a whole raft of different applications that could be really valuable for managing invasive species. So just to give you a bit of a snapshot of what that looks like, this is our user interface. It all works offline, so it doesn't matter sort of how remote you are. You just download the maps before you head out and then you've got everything you need. It has its own communication system, so the whole time while you're flying, the data is coming in. And it's been set up so you don't really need any specific lengthy training or anything to use it. You just simply work from the top to the bottom in the buttons. You send the tag information, you start tracking, and you'll start to see the data coming through. Now, what that looks like once you've got some tagged animals out there, from the first rotation that I mentioned, you start to get bearings on a map, and then you know where to go with the drone to maximise the data that you can collect by getting really nice angles based on those first bearings. As soon as you get intersecting lines, you get the points on a map. Each of those points, you can click on it, you can see the coordinates, the labels for the animals. You can have it labeled automatically as well. And down the bottom, you can see there just a bit of a snippet from a CSV file as to what that data actually looks like. So the output from the tracking is a CSV file with every frequency coordinate as well as an accuracy measure so that you know how confident you are that it's in a particular location. So this is not an invasive pest, but the opposite in danger, but often there's a lot of pest control around species to enable these threatened species to exist on islands like down on Fenuaho in New Zealand. And within a two-hour period where we were radio tracking with the drone from up the top of the mountain, we had great line of sight, so we could pretty much cover half of the island from one spot. And in 2 hours, we could do more than 4 days' worth of manual tracking work from the people on the ground. this is particularly important, I think, for a lot of those small pests and invasive animals on islands, which are really hard to track in other ways, that this now gives you capability to look over the ridge and into the gullies and anywhere that you need to in a really flexible way. And just give you access to places that you otherwise wouldn't have. So you can collect more data more often for animals with radio tags. Now, I think this matches really nicely with drone thermal imaging, and Pete's given us, you know, quite a rundown on the sort of outputs of the thermal imagery. There's, you know, been many presentations talking about the use of thermal, whether it be on scopes on guns or from helicopters, whatever. This is just another platform that can be used that might work at the right scale for some projects. And so sometimes it can be used for actually monitoring populations, going around and actually getting a census of what's there before and after you do control measures. You obviously don't need to tag the animal. So it can also be used, though, to find animals that you then want to tag for Judas animal management. There are challenges with thermal cameras in terms of the conditions in which they can be used and in drones more broadly. But in burnt and wet landscapes or dense vegetation, obviously there's some extra challenges on capturing really good imagery. Give you an example of what some of that looks like. Kangaroos, as Pete said, on off, there's always some kangaroos hanging around anywhere you go, and feral pigs, rabbits, any of these things. And obviously the bigger animals are where it's easier. And so you can find them from further away. So I think one of the nice things with the thermal imaging is if you're actually looking for where these animals are, you can send the drone out, do some scoping for you before you take your whole team up into remote valleys, etc. You can record the data so you can actually do repeated monitoring of sites really easily. And the artificial intelligence mentioned here is really centered around the type of work that Pete's doing there, which I think is fantastic, and we'd be really keen to contribute to those projects as much as we can. To give you an example in the wildlife space of how using a combination of these two different technologies, actually locating koalas can be really challenging, and so the thermal camera can be used to actually not only provide a census of what's there on the ground, but also find animals for tagging. Then they can be radio tracked, and we can pick up the signals from further away than can be done on the ground. For example, at one of the sites that we've been working at, the handheld tracking can cover about 6,000 hectares, but from the same locations we can cover 19,000 hectares in a single day. So we can really amplify the reach that we have when trying to find these really cryptic animals. In terms of invasive species, this is a similar situation that can be done. You can use the thermal to actually find the pests over a large area. It's much easier, obviously, in open habitats than dense ones. But if you actually can tag some animals, then you can find where those animals are and actually assist in the AI side of things by capturing thermal imagery of known animals where you positively identified them. So I think there's a practical on-ground immediate benefit of using this type of tech, but there's also that contribution to the research around those automations. So I think that's a really nice thing that we'd like to do and contribute to. And I think the smaller vertebrate pests are the ones that people often, it's really hard, right? So if we can tag them and actually build up a library, then that would be something we'd be really keen to get involved with. I'd love to hear about, you know, any other ideas that people might have in relation to using these two different types of sensors. Thank you.
Thanks, Debbie. That was really interesting. I've just got a bit of a left of field quick question for you to consider. I'd be really interested in your thoughts on how you think the data that's being generated from either tracking or infrared drones might change or might improve if we were allowed to fly drones at night.
You can fly drones at night. Absolutely. You just need to have the right certifications.
Okay.
And so that's indeed where the best results are obtained, because you've got that difference in temperature. Everything does pop out of the landscape a lot more. And especially when you're further north where you're in a really warm environment, you really have to do it in the middle of the night. That's just sort of a standard practice, I guess, in the drone world in terms of thermal.
Yeah, I'm not aware of that. Are those certifications hard to come by, or is Is it standard across the board, like you mentioned?
No, I mean, it's something that, yeah, you can achieve. It's not out of reach by any means, but it does. Having said that, the flying is one aspect of it, but the skill in finding what you're looking for, it takes a lot of practice. So there's some really experienced pilots that I know have really failed to really be able to successfully detect wildlife. It's a bit of a different application. Most drone pilots haven't had the opportunity to go and chase wildlife, but for those who do, they really do become quite specialised, because that skill is sort of offered quite broadly, but this takes a particular knowledge to really capture the best imagery.
Yeah, great. And if you can just address this one really quickly. Hi, Debbie. Very interesting. This is from Matthew Amos. How would the cost of using GPS VHF collars plus wildlife drones compared to the cost of GPS satellite collars?
Yeah, look, it's a really good question. I think the question there is really looking at you need to understand what the question is that's trying to be answered by each project. So, for example, if you want to have tracks of where everything goes, then GPS collars might be where you want to be. If you want real-time information on where the animals are right now, then you might want to do some radio tracking or that thermal imaging if you're not tagging. The satellite costs, I actually don't know what the satellite costs are, but I hear that they're quite large and ongoing, and usually you really have to, and the cost of the tags are order of magnitude more expensive. So the VHF versus the GPS versus the satellite. So I think it's really important for any project to just really identify what is the question you're trying to answer, and what is the size of the animal and the tag that is possible, and then the best options lay out before you.
Yeah. Great. Thanks, Debbie.